The year 1847 saw the publication of some of the greatest novels in the English language. Charlotte Bronte's Jane Eyre, Emily Bronte's Wuthering Heights, and although not so well known as her sister's works, Anne Bronte's Agnes Grey.
After childhood spent scribbling away in tiny homemade books, followed by brief unhappy periods working as teachers and governesses, it looked as though the Brontes could finally make a living from doing what had always been so vitally important to them, their writing.
Anne Bronte's first novel, Agnes Grey, was a quiet tale of governess life which suffered from being published together with Emily's tour de force, Wuthering Heights. The same could not be said of her second novel, The Tenant of Wildfell Hall, in which she adopted a more radical feminist theme. The novel was published in June 1848, when women were without property rights or legal status.
In the novel, Helen falls in love with a handsome rake, Arthur Huntingdon, and marries him against the advice of her relatives. Any hopes that she entertained of reforming him are quickly dispelled. He squanders her fortune, and when his corrupting influence starts to take hold of their young son, she runs away, taking her son with her, and becomes the mysterious tenant of Wildfell Hall.
The novel was coloured by having witnessed her brother Branwell's decline into alcoholism and disgrace. Many readers and reviewers were shocked by its stark depiction of the harrowing effects of alcoholism, and Anne was charged with a morbid love of the coarse, if not the brutal. Lady readers were advised against reading the novel, which sold so well that it quickly went into a second edition. Typical of the reviews which appeared at the time is the one from Sharp's London magazine, which expressed deep regret that the novel should be
rendered unfit for the perusal of the very class of person to whom it would be most useful, namely, imaginative girls likely to risk their happiness on the forlorn hope of marrying and reforming a captivating rake. Owing to the profane expressions, inconceivably coarse language, and revolting scenes and descriptions by which its pages are disfigured.
Surprised at the hostility of the reviews, Anne wrote a preface to the second edition of The Tenant, in which she defended her reasons for writing the book. In the preface, she writes, "I wish to tell the truth. The truth always conveys its own moral to those who are able to receive it." And she goes on to say, "Let it not be imagined, however, that I consider myself competent to reform the errors and abuses of society, but only that I would fain contribute my humble quota towards so good an aim. And if I can gain the public ear at all, I would rather whisper a few wholesome truths therein than much soft nonsense." In September 1848, Anne's brother Branwell died suddenly at the age of 31. His health had been undermined by alcohol and opium addiction, but no one had realised how seriously ill Branwell had become. The following month, Charlotte wrote to her close friend, Ellen Nussey, "I feel much more uneasy about my sisters than myself just now. Emily's cold and cough are very obstinate. I fear she has pain in the chest, and I sometimes catch a shortness in her breathing when she has moved at all quickly. She looks very, very thin and pale. Her reserved nature occasions one great uneasiness of mind. It is useless to question her. You get no answers. It is still more useless to recommend remedies. They are never adopted. Nor can I shut my eyes to the fact of Anne's great delicacy of constitution." It is said that Branwell's funeral was the last time that Emily Bronte left the parsonage alive. Her illness advanced rapidly, and she persisted in refusing all medical aid until the morning of the 19th of December, when she told her sisters that, "If you will send for a doctor, I will see him now." Dr. Wheelhouse, the Haworth surgeon, was immediately sent for, but arrived too late. Emily died that same afternoon at the age of 30, just 3 months after her brother. Anne is thought to have been asthmatic and had been suffering from what was believed to be a cold. Following Emily's death, concern about Anne's health intensified. It soon became clear that she was also seriously ill.
Fearing that Dr. Wheelhouse was out of his depth, Mr. Bronte called in a specialist. On the 5th of January 1849, Anne was examined by Mr. Teal, a well-respected physician from Leeds and an expert in consumptive cases. Ellen Nussey, Charlotte's friend from school days, who was staying with the family at the time, recalled that whilst consultations were taking place in Mr. Bronte's study, Anne was very lively in conversation, walking around the room supported by me. After Dr. Teal's departure, Mr. Bronte joined us, and seating himself on the couch, he drew Anne towards him and said, "My dear little Anne." That was all, but it was understood.
Mr. Teal had confirmed that Anne was suffering from tuberculosis, or consumption as it was often called, the same disease which had so recently caused the deaths of her brother and sister. Dr. Teal intimated that the disease was far advanced and prescribed cod liver oil and carbonate of iron for Anne. And remembering how her father and Charlotte had suffered through Emily's refusal to follow any course of medical treatment, Anne submitted to all the useless remedies he recommended, even though she described the cod liver oil as smelling and tasting like train oil, which left her feeling nauseous. While Anne suffered her own fears and anguish, Charlotte faced the prospect of a future alone. In a letter written shortly after Anne's diagnosis, she wrote, "When we lost Emily, I thought we had drained the very dregs of our cup of trial. But now when I hear Anne cough as Emily coughed, I tremble lest there should be exquisite bitterness yet to taste. However, I must not look forwards, nor must I look backwards. Too often I feel like one crossing an abyss on a narrow plank. A glance round might quite unnerve." In early February, Anne's symptoms had improved slightly, but any hopes of a recovery were short-lived, and by the middle of March she was once again plagued by a troublesome cough and pain in her side. Mr. Bronte had a keen interest in medical matters, and his well-thumbed copy of Graham's Modern Domestic Medicine recommends air, change and travel for anyone suffering from consumption.
Clearly the option of travelling had been discussed with Mr. Teal, for Mr. Bronte added a note at the foot of the page stating that Mr. Teal, surgeon, Leeds, said that change of scene and climate could prove beneficial only in the early stages of consumption, that afterwards the excitement caused by change of scenes and beds and strange company did harm.
Towards the end of March, Ellen Nussey wrote to invite Anne to her home, Brookroyd at Birstall, where she and her sisters could look after her and give Charlotte a break from nursing. Reluctant to impose on the Nussies' kindness, Anne asked Charlotte to write to Ellen on her behalf, suggesting instead that Ellen accompany her on a visit to the seaside. In private, Charlotte expressed her concerns to Ellen about the plan. "Papa says her state is most precarious. She may be spared for some time, or a sudden alteration might remove her ere we were aware. Were such an alteration to take place while she was far from home and alone with you, it would be too terrible. The idea of it distresses me inexpressibly, and I tremble whenever she alludes to the project of a journey. In short, I wish we could gain time and see how she gets on." Charlotte was clearly anxious about her sister's fluctuating state of health and reported to Ellen that Anne is very much emaciated, far more so than when you were with us. Her arms are no thicker than a child's. The least exertion brings a shortness of breath. She goes out a little every day. but we creep rather than walk. But Anne had set her heart on travelling to the seaside, and Mr. Teal had proved to be an ally, supporting her decision to travel to Scarborough on the Yorkshire coast. Anne had visited Scarborough several times whilst working as governess to the Robinson family of Thorpe Green Hall near York. She had grown to love the town, and all her remaining energy was now focused on making the journey a reality. Charlotte could only see the difficulties of travelling to Scarborough and must have dreaded the thought of her sister dying away from home. Eventually, despairing of Charlotte's attempts to delay the journey, Anne took matters into her own hands and wrote to Ellen in early April. Anne's beautifully written crossed letter still survives here at the parsonage. In the letter, Anne writes, "You say May is a trying month, and so say others. The earlier part is often cold enough, I acknowledge, but according to my experience, we are almost certain to have some fine warm days in the latter half, when the laburnums and lilacs are in bloom, whereas June is often cold and July generally wet." Charlotte continued to delay over the proposed trip, but the matter was eventually settled by Mr. Bronte himself, who insisted on Charlotte accompanying Anne. Ellen agreed to travel with the sisters, and arrangements were made to set out on Wednesday the 23rd of May. On the actual day, Anne was far too ill to travel, and the journey had to be put off until the following day. Ellen Nussey had arranged to meet the sisters at the railway station in Leeds, and one can only imagine her anxiety when they failed to turn up. They were unable to get a message to her, and Ellen waited several hours, during which time she watched as coffins were carried from two separate arrivals on the line by which she was expecting her friends to arrive, and carried out to waiting hearses.
The three women set out again at noon on the following day, Thursday the 24th of May. Ellen Nussey, according to Mrs. Gaskell, set out for Haworth from her home in Birstall, arriving just as Anne was being carried to a chaise waiting at the parsonage gate. Anne had already said her goodbyes to Emily's dog Keeper and her own dog Flossie. Mr. Bronte and the parsonage servants had all gathered to say their farewells, all knowing in their hearts that they would never see Anne again. Then Anne, Ellen and Charlotte travelled to Keighley, where they caught the 1:30 train to Leeds.
The next stage of their journey was to York, where they stayed overnight at the George Hotel, an old coaching inn on Coney Street. The inn, which dated from 1614, was demolished in 1868, and today the site is occupied by modern shops. Only part of the gateway and a pillar to the coaching yard survives. A plaque on the wall commemorates Charlotte and Anne Bronte's stay here in 1849.
The plaque also records that in Elizabethan times, Ralph Rokeby Esquire, who died in 1575, Secretary of the Council of the North, lived in a house on this site.
Subsequently, for about 2.5 centuries, the site was occupied by the George Inn, from which horse-drawn coaches departed to Hull, Manchester and Newcastle. The York to Scarborough coaches had also started out from the George, and Anne, who had travelled from there on several occasions when holidaying with her employers, the Robinson family, before the opening of the railway in 1845. It had a large galleried quadrangle and a fantastically decorated frontage with elaborate plasterwork. One can imagine coaches tearing along Coney Street and turning sharply into the narrow entrance. When passengers on the roof complained that they nearly had their heads knocked off, the coachman would say, "Don't worry, there was over an inch to spare." After they had rested and had a meal at the inn, Anne, Charlotte and Ellen set out to explore the historic streets of York, with Anne in a bath chair. It seems that Anne and Charlotte were in need of suitable clothing for their time in Scarborough, a fashionable resort patronised by well-to-do northern families. Faint pencilled notes in Charlotte's account book show that whilst in York, the sisters purchased new bonnets and gloves. The other items on their list were never purchased. Before travelling on to Scarborough the following day, Anne was determined that they should all visit York Minster. Anne had last visited the Minster in the summer of 1845, when she and Emily had enjoyed a day out together. As Anne gazed up at the magnificent building, she was moved to utter the words, "If finite power can do this, what is the..." Before she was overcome by emotion, and in Ellen Nuss's words, hastened to a less exciting scene. For the last stage of their journey, the three women travelled by train. Charlotte had booked first-class travel at a cost of £1.10. At each stage of the journey, they found willing assistance wherever they needed it, with helping Anne in and out of carriages. The journey must have been a difficult one for Anne, who was by now very frail and weak. Ellen, already warned what to expect by Charlotte, tried hard to disguise how shocked she was at seeing how thin and ill Anne had become. The familiar sights of Scarborough revived Anne, and she was determined that Charlotte and Ellen should make the most of their stay. The Robinsons had stayed in the fashionable Woods Lodgings on St. Nicholas Cliff, overlooking the South Bay, which Anne declared to be the best situation in the town. A legacy of £200 from her godmother enabled them to book rooms overlooking the sea in the same establishment. Woods Lodgings consisted of a large four-storied house and two adjacent cottages dating from the Regency period. The house and cottages gave onto a square, in the centre of which was an oval-shaped garden surrounded by wrought iron railings. Woods Lodgings were demolished and the entire site is now occupied by the Grand Hotel, completed in 1867, which was one of the largest hotels in Europe. Nowadays, a blue wall plaque commemorates Anne Bronte's stay at number 2, The Cliff.
We have a detailed account of Anne's final days in Scarborough written by Ellen Nussey. On the morning after their arrival, Saturday the 26th, Anne insisted on visiting one of the several saltwater baths and staying there with just an attendant while Charlotte and Ellen explored the town. She attempted the walk back to their lodgings alone but collapsed at the garden gate. Anne insisted that the servants should not inform Charlotte and Ellen, and so they only learnt of the incident at a later date.
That same afternoon, she was sufficiently recovered to drive herself in a donkey cart along the sands for an hour. She took the reins herself so that she and the donkey could go at their own gentle pace.
When Ellen returned later, she found Anne lecturing the donkey boy in taking better care of his animal.
On Sunday the 27th of May, Anne was keen to attend church, but was dissuaded by Charlotte and Ellen. She walked a little in the afternoon, and then found a comfortable seat near the beach, urging her companions to leave her and to explore some of Scarborough and the places she had loved. She was anxious that both Charlotte and Ellen should understand why she was so attached to the town.
Trying to preserve a holiday atmosphere must have put a great strain on Charlotte and Ellen, and the idea of seeking pleasure must have been far from their thoughts on that afternoon.
Ellen recalled that the evening closed in a glorious sunset. Anne sat in a comfortable chair near the window at their lodgings, watching the scene, her face illuminated in the golden light. Once again, she tried to persuade her companions to attend the church service, but they declined, saying they preferred to remain with her. As the sun's rays faded, she joined her companions by the fire. It seems that up until that point, she had dared to hope that being in Scarborough, a special place for her, would make recovery a possibility. It was then, for the first time, she mentioned returning home to Haworth, saying she did not wish it for her own sake, but because she feared that if she were to die away from home, she felt that the awful task of accompanying her lifeless remains back to Haworth would be more than Charlotte could bear. Anne passed a reasonably comfortable night and arose at 7 o'clock the following morning, dressing herself and being the first to be ready to go downstairs for breakfast. As she reached the top of the staircase, however, she was overcome by faintness and told her sister and friend that she was afraid to descend. Ellen offered to carry her downstairs, while Charlotte, anxious and unable to bear watching, was persuaded to wait in her bedroom. Ellen went down the first few steps, then told Anne to put her arms around her neck, saying, "I will carry you like a baby." She promised to put her down if she became too heavy, and they had almost reached the bottom of the stairs when Anne's head suddenly fell forward like a dead weight on top of Ellen's. Ellen, shaken by the blow and fearing that it could only have been caused by Anne having died, staggered over to an easy chair and almost dropped Anne into it. She then knelt before Anne and was reassured that she still lived. Anne had an invalid breakfast of boiled milk and bread, and nothing untoward happened until around 11 o'clock, when Anne said that she felt a change approaching and that she believed she didn't have long to live. A doctor was summoned, and Anne asked him if it would be possible for her to reach home alive if they were to set out immediately for Haworth. She appealed to him to tell her the truth, for she was not afraid to die. The doctor reluctantly confirmed that she did not have long to live. She thanked him for his truthfulness and he left, returning several times over the next few hours to check on her. For some time afterwards, Anne remained in her chair. She then thanked Charlotte and Ellen for all their kindness to her, invoking a blessing on each. She became restless as death approached and was helped to the sofa. Ellen described how, on being asked if she was easier, she looked gratefully at her questioner and said, "It is not you who can give me ease, but soon all will be well through the merits of my Redeemer." Shortly after this, seeing that her sister could hardly restrain her grief, she said, "Take courage, Charlotte, take courage." Anne died at about 2 o'clock that same afternoon, Monday the 28th of May 1849. She was 29 years of age. Her end was so quiet that no one else in the house was disturbed. Ellen recalled that, so still and so hallowed were her last hours and moments, there was no thought of assistance or dread. The doctor came and went 3 times in 2 hours. The hostess knew that death was near, yet so little was the house disturbed by the presence of the dying and the bereaved that dinner was announced through the half-open door as the living sister was closing the eyes of the dying one. Charlotte's grief was overwhelming. In the space of 9 months, she had lost her brother and 2 much-loved sisters. Next came the question of removing Anne's body back to Haworth for burial in the family vault, a melancholy task which was never carried out. Charlotte took the decision to spare her 72-year-old father the anguish of a third family funeral and to bury Anne at Scarborough instead. Although Anne had not expressed a preference for place, Charlotte knew that Scarborough was a place her sister had loved. Arrangements were quickly made, and by the time Mr. Bronte received Charlotte's letter telling him of the funeral, there was no time for him to make the arduous journey to Scarborough. Anne's funeral was held 2 days after her death, on Wednesday the 30th of May. Ellen registered Anne's death that same day, giving her age incorrectly as 28 years and giving the cause of death as consumption 6 months.
Building work was being carried out at the parish church St Mary's, so the quiet funeral service took place at Christ Church on Vernon Road. This was just a few minutes' walk from Wood's lodgings and was the church which Anne had attended with the Robinson family. The church stood on this site next to Scarborough Library but was demolished in 1979.
The entry in the burial register describes Anne as being from near York, information which would not have been provided by Charlotte or Ellen, and which suggests that Anne was known and remembered there. The doctor's offer of attendance was respectfully declined, although the service was attended by Charlotte's friend and former schoolmistress, Miss Margaret Wooler, who was staying in Scarborough at the time. The small group of mourners then made their way up to St Mary's Churchyard, high upon the cliff, where Anne was laid to rest.
Charlotte's decision not to have Anne interred in the family vault at Haworth has been called into question, but it seems that she may have considered the possibility of having her sister's remains transferred there at some future day. In a letter dated shortly after the funeral, she writes, "For the present, Anne's ashes rest apart from the others. I have buried her at Scarborough to save Papa the anguish of the return and a third funeral." In the same letter, Charlotte gives an account of Anne's death.
She died without struggle, resigned, trusting in God, thankful for release from a suffering life, deeply assured that a better existence lay before her. She believed, she hoped, and declared her belief and hope with her last breath. Her quiet Christian death did not rend my heart as Emily's stern, simple, undemonstrative end did. I let Anne go to God and felt he had a right to her. I could hardly let Emily go. I wanted to hold her back then and I want her back hourly now. Anne from her childhood seemed preparing for an early death. Emily's spirit seemed strong enough to bear her to fullness of years. They are both gone, and so is poor Branwell. And Papa has now me only, the weakest, puniest, least promising of his 6 children. Consumption has taken the whole 5. Charlotte and Ellen remained in Scarborough for another week, taking walks on the sands and visiting the castle. Charlotte also made the arrangements for Anne's gravestone and the inscription on it. They soon began to find the fashionable crowds at Scarborough too gay, and on the 7th of June moved to Filey, where they lodged at Cliff House. Mr. Bronte was keen for his daughter to spend time on the Yorkshire coast, hoping that she would benefit from time spent in the sea air. Charlotte finally arrived home on the 21st of June 1849. In a letter, she described her homecoming. "I am now again at home, where I returned last Thursday. I call it home still, much as London would be called London if an earthquake should shake its streets to ruins. But let me not be ungrateful. Haworth Parsonage is still a home for me, and not quite a ruined or desolate home either. Papa is there, and two most affectionate and faithful servants, and two old dogs in their ways faithful and affectionate. Emily's large house dog, which lay at the side of her dying bed and followed her funeral to the vault, lying in the pew couched at our feet whilst the burial service was being read. And Anne's little spaniel. The ecstasy of these poor animals when I came in was something singular. At former returns from brief absences, they always welcomed me warmly, but not in that strange, heart-touching way. I am certain they thought that, as I was returned, my sisters were not far behind. But here my sisters will come no more. Keeper may visit Emily's little bedroom, as he still does day by day, and Flossie may look wistfully round for Anne. They will never see them again, nor shall I. At least the human part of me. Three years after Anne's death, Charlotte revisited her sister's grave. In a letter to Ellen, she wrote, "On Friday, I went to Scarborough, visited the churchyard and stone. It must be refaced and relettered. There are five errors. One of the errors still remains, for Anne's age at death is given as 28 instead of 29. Charlotte's desire to present Anne before the public as gentle, mild and stoical led her to make significant changes to Anne's work after her death. In an 1850 edition of Emily's Wuthering Heights and Anne's Agnes Grey, Charlotte included a selection of poetry written by both of her sisters. One of these was Anne's last known poem, written shortly after her illness was diagnosed as consumption. Charlotte removed all references to Anne's struggle to accept the unjustness of her situation, also changing the direct form of address, so that the poem appeared as a public statement of Anne's resigned acceptance of her fate. Charlotte's disapproval also meant that Anne's novel, The Tenant of Wildfell Hall, remained out of print for 10 years after Anne's death. Charlotte believed the book hardly desirable to preserve and was unable to reconcile her image of dear gentle Anne with the book's unpleasant subject matter. The choice of subject was an entire mistake, she wrote, adding, nothing less congruous with the writer's nature could be conceived. Anne Bronte has often been overlooked and her works compared unfavourably with those of her elder sisters. It seems that Charlotte herself pointed out the way in a depreciation of her youngest sister, which has meant that Anne has been denied recognition as a major literary figure. More recently, critics have begun to appreciate The Tenant of Wildfell Hall, which was described by one critic as the first sustained feminist novel. A re-evaluation of Anne's work has got underway and led one writer to claim that Anne Bronte would have passed for a genius in any of the family. The death of Anne Bronte at Scarborough has been seen as the pathetic end of a tragic life. Charlotte said that she wished Anne to die where she had been happiest, and the journey to Scarborough has come to be seen as Anne's dying wish. Charlotte always seems to have regarded Anne as the baby of the family and been overly protective of her. But it's absolutely clear from Anne's last letter to Ellen Nussey that she came to Scarborough to be cured, not to die here. Although Anne's doctor, Mr. Teal, had not been overly optimistic, he had not ruled out the possibility of recovery. In her letter to Ellen, Anne had written, "The doctors say that change of air or removal to a better climate would hardly ever fail of success in consumptive cases if the remedy were taken in time. But the reason why there are so many disappointments is that it is generally deferred till it is too late. Now, I would not commit this error, And to say the truth, I suffer much less from pain and fever than I did when you were with us. I am decidedly weaker and much thinner. My cough still troubles me a good deal, especially in the night. And what seems worse than all, I am subject to a great shortness of breath on going upstairs or any slight exertion. Under these circumstances, I think there is no time to be lost. I have no horror of death, but I wish it would please God to spare me, not only for Papa's and Charlotte's sakes, but because I long to do some good in the world before I leave it. I have many schemes in my head for future practice, humble and limited indeed, but still I should not like them all to come to nothing, and myself to have lived to so little purpose.